What is the purpose of zoos today and should they exist?
Why do you still serve beef and dairy products at the zoo? Shouldn't you be vegan?
Should we let nature take its course and let some species die out?
Grab the first question.
Sure.
Is it worth doing all this work for threatened species?
I hate this question.
Yes. I can say hands down, absolutely.
Absolutely. I get up every day and I come to work because I know we can make a difference.
Every species has its role in the ecosystem. And they, you know, so I work with digging mammals. They turn over the soil, they improve soil health. So you take them away and you've got poor quality soils.
This world is so amazing because of the little animals that share it with us. Whether those are Bobo frogs or Lord Howe Island stick insects, it's that diversity that makes this planet so special.
I mean, it's tough work though, right?
Yeah, it's not easy.
Yeah.
And it can be depressing at times, yeah.
But it's worth it for the little wins, I think. Like,
absolutely. You
know, you hear that little frog call or, you know,
yep.
Find those little bandicoot burrows.
We've done, as humans, so much damage to our environment and to the other inhabitants of our Earth.
Humans are pretty selfish, so generally the question is, what's in it for me or what's in it for us? All of these species play a critical role in the ecosystem for one reason or another. So by removing them, we have a trickle-on and flow-on effect that will no doubt start to affect people as well.
I would say there's a lot at stake in not protecting our species and our environments. But yeah, looking at that really big picture is often very challenging for people.
It's definitely worth it. It gives us a richer life. It makes the environment, more healthy in just about every way that you can think of.
All right, ready for the next one?
Yeah.
All right.
Is it expensive saving threatened species?
Yeah, I guess it does require an investment of money.
Probably nothing compared to being offset by the money that people and organisations make from degrading the habitats that we're then sort of going back to and trying to repair and save the species that have been affected. So no cost is too great at this point, I would say.
We have the expertise, we know what to do, it's just we struggle to get the funds.
Yeah, I think frogs pretty economical as well, you know.
Yeah.
What you can do in like one frog bunker, you can, you know, raise 150 frogs and really supplement a population in like smaller spaces, so it can be quite efficient.
Often when we try to work at the end of saving species, it's like going into a hospital and needing ICU. It's much cheaper to do the things that stop species getting into trouble. It's much cheaper to protect their habitat, to keep trees in the ground, to keep the environment perfect for them. But sometimes this is what it takes. And I would hate to think that when I needed ICU, someone said it was too expensive and it wasn't there. I would hate to think that when an animal needs Zoos Victoria in order to survive, we would say it was too expensive and we're not there. We should be there.
Yeah. Should we let nature take its course and let some species die out? Survival of the fittest, etc.
Yeah, it's a good one.
I've heard this before, it's really interesting. And I understand superficially why that's the first thought.
This planet is so complicated. How are we ever going to decide which animals should just die out and which ones are important? Already as humans, we've created a mess. And I think we teach little children when they create a mess, they should tidy it up.
Morally, I think that we're obliged to do everything we can. We can't stand by and watch species become extinct when ultimately we as human race are very responsible for that.
We're contributing to the problem, then we should be contributing to the solution, really.
Absolutely, yeah. All these foxes and cats and rabbits, you know, all these introduced species that don't belong here, we did that. Humans did that.
Yeah.
And our wildlife is suffering because of it. So I think, yeah, absolutely, we should be part of the solution.
Yep.
It's not just that one species that goes extinct. That's an indicator of overall health of that environment.
Frogs, for example, they're a keystone species. They're environmental indicators and kind of they're indicating if the environment's poor and if something like that is happening, then we really should be paying attention.
All right, next question. How do you ensure the threatened species you work with are able to be released back into the wild?
Yeah.
Do you want to go first?
Good question. I guess, it's a little bit different with frogs. They kind of maintain a lot of their natural wild behaviours, so we can kind of release them and be pretty happy that they'll survive in the wild. But I don't know, bandicoots, how do they go?
Bandicoots are super easy. Oh my goodness. They make it incredibly easy. So they are adaptable to different habitat requirements. They're just like open areas for foraging and denser areas for nesting. So they can find food anywhere and they breed really well. And yeah, it's just a case of finding fox-free areas and the rest is easy.
For me, the best part about working with endangered animals is that moment when you let them go back in the wild and they just run away into a new life. And you know that for this critically endangered tiny population, there's one more animal in it. And then we do that again and again, we can bring a population back from the brink of extinction.
All right, oh, we're back to the start.
Oh, we finished.
Do you want to answer it again?
No.
Thank you so much. No worries.
Blank.
Really? Seems like no one likes this answer. And if we let one go, why don't we let the next one and the next one, and then all we're left with is cockroaches and seagulls.